Hello everyone. Welcome and thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Using a Learning Landscape to Ensure Your Customer Success, brought to you by Technology Services Industry Association and sponsored by Ansiley. My name is Inga Intriago, your moderator for today. Before we get started, we just have a few housekeeping items. To maximize your webinar experience, click the question icon in the upper right corner of the registration to check your system for the most recent versions of browsers and Flash Player. Update to the most recent version available for the optimal viewing experience. Audio will be delivered via streaming. You'll be in listen-only mode and need to listen via your computer or mobile device. Please check that your computer speakers are turned on. Webinar controls, including volume, are found below the presenter headshot area. To view your webinar, select your link to proceed to the player. If you're already registered, you can access by entering your email only at the top of the registration form, and you can join the webinar from any device. Ask questions at any time by sending your questions via the Ask a Question box on the left side of the webinar player. Feel free to enlarge the slides to full screen at any time via the Full Screen button, which will appear on the top right area of the slide area. There will be an exit survey at the end of today's webinar. Please provide your feedback on the content and experience by filling out the brief survey. And finally, a link to a recorded version of today's webinar and access to download the PDF of the presentation will be sent out in the next 24 hours via email. Once again, thank you for taking the time to join us today. I'd now like to introduce our presenters today, John Ragsdale, VP Research, Technology, and Social for TSIA, and Mal Poulin, Senior Director of Corporate Strategy for Ansiley. We do have a lot of exciting content to cover in the next 30 minutes, so let's jump right in and get started. John, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Inga. Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. Very excited to talk about an aspect of the big customer success movement that we really haven't covered much at TSIA, and that is the role of education services and learning tools in ensuring customer success. So I'm sure you've all seen this slide. We first introduced this when our executives published their very first book a number of years ago, Complexity Avalanche, talking about the consumption gap. And the concept of the consumption gap is that today's technology is becoming so complex that it's getting harder and harder for customers to learn to use the tools and to become proficient in the tools. And the longer it takes to master the technology, the slower the time to value. So we're seeing that customers buy a product anticipating a certain level of value, and when they receive a little bit lower value than anticipated, we're creating that consumption gap. And the problem with the consumption gap is if customers aren't getting the perceived value, it makes them less likely to sign up again or to renew a subscription agreement or to purchase additional products and services. So this consumption gap is what really is at the root of the customer success movement. And the customer success movement is all about helping customers be successful to allow them to more fully consume technology so they will purchase more and go ahead and be net promoters, they're very satisfied, etc. When we survey companies doing customer success and ask about the focus of the group, you can see that the largest percent, 40%, are focused on adoption. We know that customers who adopt products faster and more fully obviously are going to eliminate that consumption gap, which means that they're going to be more loyal customers and be more likely to purchase more from you. And as a proof point, our benchmark data shows that the companies who are monitoring consumption, meaning they know who's using what, can identify the customers who are too slow to adopt and reach out to them to help with additional onboarding capabilities. We see that they have a much higher renewal rate, 86% renewal compared to 77% for companies that cannot track consumption. So, we know that companies are interested in boosting adoption and consumption, and there are many different approaches to trying this. And thanks to Julia Stegman, our VP of Research for Service Revenue Generation, for allowing me to use this slide. This is from her emerging offer survey she conducted at the end of last year, finding out what various approaches companies are trying to improve adoption. And you can see there are a lot of different approaches across the adoption planning before the customer has even gone live, monitoring their use of the tool, optimizing the tool, making sure that they're using it as effectively as possible, and sometimes even process consulting, because it could be that they have processes that are so broken that it's getting in the way of them consuming the product fully. So I'd like to bring in Mal Polin, Senior Director of Product Strategy for Ansilie, our guest speaker today. Mal, I was just wondering if you had some comments on various aspects of these adoption services that relate to education and learning.
I do. Thank you, John. I do. Because we have so much here on this slide, what I wanted to do is sort of highlight a few of the more discrete components of each of the service offerings for adoption services that's relevant to today's discussion, as John pointed them out. So even like in the first column for adoption planning, I think one of the words there that's most important that we can concentrate on is onboarding, onboarding new users, onboarding new customers. In the consumption monitoring area, all of them that start with the word adoption, focusing on the users adopting and different aspects of that. For the consumption optimization, that's when I think we can focus on things like super user programs. And then when we look at process consulting, like John just said too, looking at process improvement and even new capabilities of your software with your customers. So focusing on those six areas, I think, are relevant for the rest of the conversation here. I appreciate it. This is, so far, it's really been a valuable experience.
Fantastic, Mal. Thanks for jumping in there. So before we go further, I'd like to call everyone's attention to a great piece of research. Our VP of Research for Education Services, Maria Manning Chapman, who's not only brilliant, is also one of the nicest people you will ever meet. And she just published this report, The Role of Education Services in Customer Success. Those of you who are TSIA members can download this report from our website, and I would encourage you to give it a read. It is a really great report. And also, many companies have a lot of budget for customer success. So if you are in education services, this might give you some ideas of how you can tap in to that budget for 2017, because we know that 2017 planning is about to get started. So I wanted to talk a little bit about what I call the technology learning continuum. And this is a look at various approaches, who gets trained and when they get trained, or when the learning occurs, and we can see that while some of this has not changed a lot since the traditional on-premise world, we're seeing a lot of new opportunities in providing learning as we move into the cloud world. So once that PO or the purchase order is first signed, obviously the first step is getting the system administrators trained on how to basically administer and maintain that system. This has traditionally been done in a classroom. Today we're often seeing more of that moving to an online model. And once they've figured out how to master that system, we often see another round of training or learning on the train the trainer. And this is to help them create the training plans and the content for all of the employees who will be using the technology. And the next step then is to actually train those end users on the basic operations, how to log in, the key process flows, the key features that they'll be using. And again, traditionally this was done often in a classroom, but today we're seeing a lot more self-paced learn-as-you-go programs, especially for people like call center agents. It's very difficult to pull them away from their desk for a long period of time, where with an online course they can just process a little bit at a time as their schedule permits. Then once we hit go live, we start getting into some new territory that we didn't always see in the old on-premise world. And the first is all of the new users, new people that we're hiring, people transferring into the department, and now highlighted on a previous slide, onboarding. And when we're onboarding new users, the learning aspect is very, very important, and we also see, I think, kind of an increasing trend that instead of just putting them through the technology training, it's very often in context of certain business problems. So they'll train them on the common issues they'll be dealing with at work, how to solve those problems, and the tools that they need to solve those in context of that problem. Next, we have something that we're going to be talking about today, which I think is one of the coolest things happening in the learning world, and that is in-process help. So we're seeing more help embedded within applications. So if a customer or an employee is struggling to use a particular feature or to complete a process flow, there's some online embedded help that can answer their questions, walk them through that process, and allow them to stay within the tool while getting their questions answered. And then finally, from the customer success perspective, we have identifying those low adopters, and often more common today, we see that customer success folks are identifying those low adopters and reaching out to them to provide them some additional counseling, some coaching, some training tools, and this is typically a very on-demand approach, that it is available as they need it, when they need it. It's not just something that you register in advance for. So the final thing, you know, the topic today is the learning landscape. And from my perspective, the learning landscape incorporates the people, process, and technology of getting both employees or customers up to speed on using technology. And we have various approaches, the traditional classroom, obviously manuals, distance learning, which is live online instruction delivered remotely over a desktop. And then we're seeing a lot of new capabilities that are becoming more common. Online learning, I don't think that's necessarily pace setter anymore. The adoption levels of online learning platforms are pretty high. Maria wanted me to specifically mention blended learning because the current thinking is this tends to be one of the most successful approaches for training, particularly technology. So blended includes some elements of classroom or instruction-led training and additional work that they do self-paced on their own online. So that blended seems to really help most people truly process new information as effectively as possible. And finally, that embedded just-in-time help, this is a very important part of helping people navigate and use complex technology because they can get the assistance as they need it, because it's really not possible to learn every bell and every whistle of every application and remember that, particularly when there are features such as an annual inventory feature that you may only touch once a year. So that's kind of my look at the concept of learning landscape, but we have a real expert on the topic here today. So I'm very happy to turn things over to our guest speaker, Mal Polin, Senior Director, Product Strategy for Ansilie. Mal is also a member of TSIA's Partner Advisory Board and one of my favorite webinar co-presenters. So Mal, let me turn things over to you.
Well, thanks, John. The same back to you. I really appreciate the time here. This is a great topic and I think really relevant to pretty much everyone. So as we focus on customer success as an organization within our companies, capital C, capital S, I think the message is clear. I think the other part of this is that we want to focus on the success of our customers. So we're really going to go there and focus on the users. That's a lot of our focus today. When we talk about adoption and learning, it's users that learn and users that adopt. So even on the last slide that John had up, one of the words there, I'll actually go back to it here, down in the red box, is as technology becomes more complex. One thing I'll add to that is that word complex sometimes isn't always the easiest to swallow, but I think configurable is another way to go because everyone wants the software to be about them. So with just the fact that we're evolving to constantly configurable solutions, all of a sudden the whole concept of personalization and customization of this learning is ever important because the generic doesn't cut it anymore. We need to make sure what we have is very specific to us. So now what I'd like to do is go down and put some words to what John talked about there as far as the learning landscape and sort of go down to that next level. When we talk about what we do in this learning landscape or this platform, is there's really two categories we can really discuss here, conceptual learning and procedural learning or enablement. So on the left side here, we'll talk about the conceptual. So that's maybe with his slide that he had, the timeline, pre-go-live, this is maybe where the learning occurs. It's conceptual. In other words, theoretical. It's what's going to happen. It's general instruction about the change that's about to incur, but we haven't implemented it yet. It hasn't gone live yet. You typically are going to consume that within your learning management system, perhaps, or actually use your learning management system, like John just said, to go to a classroom, you know, an instructor-led event. But in either case, you still have to reserve your seat or reserve or your access to the learning content, whether it's virtual or whether it's traditional or physical. But it also could include some testing and assessment, as well as it's a scheduled time. It's an event-based kind of thing. Where we're going next, though, is adding to that, not an either-or, but adding the procedural guidance, or as we see here, EPSS, the acronym would be for Embedded Performance Support Solution. And this is what Maria is talking about as well in her work, is really putting learning at the fingertips of the user. But it's, so it's practical. It's what I need to do right now. So it's very action-oriented. Micro-learning, it's the just enough, personalized, just for me. In other words, it's not just clicking help and finding out about the software. It's maybe clicking help and finding out what I need to do right here at my company, in my role, in my language at this time. And then, of course, the difference, though, is the location. We're actually consuming this right within the application itself, providing the guidance just when I need it, the just-in-time. So when we're talking about this learning landscape, keep these two sides in mind as we keep talking here, the conceptual learning aspect and something a little bit more procedural or transactional, and at that time of need, at that time when you need to apply it. Let's see what it looks like. It looks like this. So when we're talking about this, the user is the key person here, the key actor. So in this example, maybe the user is identified and it's before the software has gone live, or maybe before the user has been onboarded. In other words, the software may be a year old, but the user's new to the environment. And that user actually needs that conceptual learning, if you look bottom left here. That conceptual learning is about what's going to happen. It's about the new processes the user's going to work, about the new business software, whether it's in for electronic medical records, if it's a healthcare provider, or like John said, in maybe a call center. Maybe we've got a CRM system. In that case, the user actually accesses a learning management system to either reserve a seat in a class or to actually access the e-learning content and consume it as needed. The difference that we have now from a technology innovation perspective is by adding an application top left here, like Ansible UPerform, that's where you can actually create the content. We'll go through that in just a second as far as how that's done. But you can also store all that content. So the learning management system is the mechanism to get to the content that resides in the UPerform database in this case. Let's go back to the user for just a second. The user now is active. The user is onboarded and ready to go, in role, with the application, with the proper user authorization, and they're using their enterprise applications like you see on the top right here. But once again, maybe retention wasn't 100% from the conceptual learning, so they have a question. What do I do now? I either don't remember, or maybe it wasn't even in the learning activity. So maybe what they'll do is they'll click help. That help request to the enterprise application will send that help request with context about who the user is and what they're doing over to, again, this Ansible UPerform as an example on this platform. And that content is then served up to the user to provide specific direction. What do I do on this screen at this time, given that I'm a buyer? Given that I am on the plant floor, whatever the person's role is, there's enough context to provide help that is context sensitive. So there's no guesswork. It's not generic. It's very specific and it's very personalized. The heart and soul of all this is the user, but the main repository for all this content is the learning content management system, which Ansible UPerform is fulfilling in this flow. Let's go down to that next level and see, what does that mean? What is this this Ansible UPerform about? What it is, it's an application that we offer, and we actually work with several members of TSIA to actually employ this for their customer success teams. So it has three areas of major functionality and value. And Finally You Perform actually focuses on the ability to create content, very specific content, as well as generic, to manage that content very easily in a collaborative platform, and then distribute it however it's needed. Well, let's go back to the first column here. For content creation, there's a recording capability so that if you need a flow, a simulation, or documentation, all the subject matter expert has to do is turn on the recorder, and then it automatically records what's going on and then creates a single source asset that can be published to many forms and used on a tablet, can be used on a PC, can be used right at the point of need based on who the user is and what their access type is. There's an editor for maintaining that content over time, so there's no more electronic dusty binder on the shelf. It really is a matter of always being up to date, and the owner of the content is obliged to keep it up to date. And we're focusing more on the subject matter expert than we ever have before for this, rather than a training organization per se alone. When we focus on the content management, it really is a matter of working collaboratively, because one subject matter expert may have the right expertise for the work, but maybe not the ability to communicate it well. So we work together as a team to make sure that it's there. We've got translation capabilities so that it's always in the language of the learner or the worker, and we can actually add multimedia to it as well. So we're always matching the needs of the consumer, the user here, and meet them where they are from the standpoint of their context and their learning needs. The content distribution goes back to the example we had before, where we, if you look down the bottom here, we can actually use different learning standards, is a good way to put it, I guess, so that the learning management system can make this content available through its own means, or we can embed it right within the application itself. We can actually set up a portal as well. So my point here is that the platform allows for the content creation, but also maintenance, very important, content management, and the distribution of that through whatever means it happens to be, right within your application, from a web portal, or from a learning management system. When John talked earlier about Maria's slant and bias in a good way towards the blended learning approach, Here's a good example of what that looks like. There are a lot of learning consultants out there, and there's one organization that actually touts this, as you see here, the model called 70-20-10. It's not rocket science. What it basically is espousing is the fact that 70% of learning typically occurs on the job. 20% occurs by actually gaining information from colleagues that you work with. Either you tap them on the shoulder, or maybe you electronically tap them on the shoulder if they happen to be in another city around the world. And 10% is still classroom-based. So whether these averages ring true for you or not, the model is clear that we learn on the job, we learn from others, and we learn in traditional classroom environments. Well, that could be either electronic or it could be traditional classroom. So my point here is that what we've talked about so far applies. We need to create content that's available on the job, from others, and in the classroom. So we're focusing on the ability now of actually one development effort to satisfy all the needs of the worker. What does it look like? It looks like this. So if we have an example of a solution here on the left side, you can actually record a simulation, perhaps, that has notes and guidance within it that helps the user through exactly what they need to do with your software, so it leaves no guesswork. Either you can create that on behalf of your customer or provide the capability of YouPerform to them for them to create it based on their specific needs. On the top right here, we can actually then make documents and these simulations available right from the actual application, maybe in the help menu. Perhaps we can link into that. And then lastly, on the bottom right, we can also integrate right within a web application and guide someone through step by step of exactly what they need. So again, there's no guesswork. Everything is prescribed. Let's take a few cases of organizations that actually use this capability, this philosophy, and the technology to satisfy their needs. A customer of ours that's been very vocal in a good way is PepsiCo. they actually worked with one of our partners, SAP, years ago, and licensed UPerform for their internal use. They received the software from SAP, but the goal specifically was to make sure that the adoption rate of their SAP software they were rolling out was 100% or as close to it as they possibly could. They, as you see here on the left side, they have a lot of different assets in different formats, straight work instructions and documents, interactive HTML simulations, as well as a lot of other documents that are not necessarily developed by UPerform, but still are part of the work process. They do use a learning management system called SuccessFactors. And the volume you see there of users started with 30,000 back in the mid-2000s, and they've evolved from just their SAP project, as you see on the top right here, to 10 different initiatives, and they're using this across the enterprise following the philosophy that we've been talking about today. They can create content, they can manage that content, and they can deploy that content for whatever their initiatives happen to be. They initially licensed specifically for their SAP rollout, but they realized they can apply it to any rollout of any initiative within. An organization that's a vibrant member of TSIA is HP, now HPE, HP Enterprise, and they actually utilize our software as well to create what they call the Adoption Readiness Tool. And it has two major components. One is content that they develop using UPerform about their software for their customers. So think of that as the conceptual learning. But they also provide our software to their customers so that the customer can actually, with maybe HP's support, or they can do it themselves, to create this procedural or transactional, very specific, customized, personalized content that's available right within the application, embedded within the application, so that they have both the conceptual and the highly personalized, highly maintained content that's relevant to the transaction and the processes that people are following. And lastly, SAP, as I mentioned, is a partner of ours as they provided to PepsiCo. They've actually been a partner of the Insilis for about 16 years in reselling our software. They actually relabeled it, as HP did with their own branding, SAP Productivity Pack. But note from their offering, their collateral that they offer, the headline on the first page of it. It's not about training or learning per se. The real value proposition here for the success of the customer is driving continuous user adoption, which is really what this customer success is built on, is that overall adoption, but not just at go-live, but every day. So those are three distinct ways that I think, as TSIA members, we can take advantage of new technologies to satisfy the strategy, and that your customers can take advantage of as well. So let me pass it back at this point to Inga and John and see if there are any questions.
Great. Thank you, Mal, and thank you, John, for a very fantastic presentation. You showed some really, really interesting and fascinating data, especially the UPerform tool. So we are going on to the Q&A portion of today's webinar. If you have any questions for John or Mal on their content, please take this opportunity to ask those questions live via the Ask a Question box on the left side of the webinar player. So we are going to go to the first question. This is for Mal. We still have a need for some traditional learning elements, such as classroom. How can UPerform help me there?
That's a good question. I think when we talk about the content development side, the first of the three pillars, the learning content that can be created is conceptual, and it can be used either from a self-facilitated perspective, in other words, I can take the course myself online, or the instructor can use that very same asset instead of possibly PowerPoint. They can actually project and interactively work with students through an e-learning course. So it either stands alone, or that very same piece, that same course, can be used in a traditional classroom environment, instructor facilitated, either in a physical classroom or an online virtual classroom, much like we're working today. That's the beauty of the single development cycle for multiple uses in the learning landscape.
Thank you, Mal. So we do have time for one more question. This question is for Mal. What does help content within an application look like typically?
In the way you launch it, I guess I'll start there, is possibly by integrating right within the business application help menu. And instead of standard help, we can actually add a capability to that to link into the UPerform database, and the help content can be straight text or highly interactive simulations of exactly what to do right there. What it looks like is stay on top help. So you've got your application open in one window, and a new window opens that guides you through exactly what to do. But the difference from old help or traditional help is this is customer or role specific. So again, there's the configuration, the screenshots, the actions, and the guidance are exactly what to do at company X versus company Y versus company Z.
Thank you, Mel. So we are coming to the conclusion of today's webinar. Just a couple of quick reminders for everyone that there will be an exit survey at the end of today's presentation. Please take a moment to provide your feedback on the content and experience by filling out that brief survey. And also, finally, there will be a link to the recorded version of today's presentation and access to download the PDF of the presentation, and that will be sent out via email within the next 24 hours, so be on the lookout for that. Again, I'd like to take this time to thank everyone for taking time out of your busy schedules to join us on today's webinar, Using a Learning Landscape to Ensure Your Customer's Success, brought to you by TSIA and sponsored by Ann Siley. I look forward to seeing you at our next webinar very soon. Have a great day, everyone.